this is where Mesos is going. So this is, I've fortunately had the benefit of being able to spend some good face time with the main architect and inventor of Mesos. He's our, several years back, wrote an academic research paper as part of his PhD dissertation that ultimately became what we call the Mesos product. And this is what he's going for, right? He wants this to be a situation which is like the computer. And like I sit down at my laptop and say, oh, I want to run Chrome, and the laptop says, well, which four would you want to run that on? And how many are we going to get? But we have to accept that in data center because we don't have any other option. But does it need to be that way? No. I mean, if they can an operating system to get to be able to support multi-core processors, it stands to reason that the data center is on the same way trajectory. Because of what I want to do, I don't want to go make a VM, I want to make a container, and da-da-da. I want to just say, give me a service problem. You know, I want to define a new service type and just say, run it. And if it needs more instances or whatever, deal with load, then deal with it. That's data center here. So, as you might imagine, when you're dealing with a situation where you have a lot of service dependency and orchestration issues and all that, that's a tough promise to deliver on. Because services don't run as an island, creating a commercial solution for this is incredibly difficult. But there are instances, I mean, Twitter is the main one. Twitter's the main, where Mesos came from. Mesos and Raw Marathon, those are all Twitter projects. They run them in production today. That's where every tweet that you make goes over those systems. And they've pretty much gotten to this. But that's because they run within very specific limits, a very certain confines, and just a certain way, and you know, look at it all, you know, and it works. So it's just something, that's the idea I want to leave you with. And thinking about my, I don't know if you work for product companies that are developing infrastructure products, or if you're just deploying specific services in a data center, it's a lot to do.
Service containers are your load balancer, your subnet are checking for load and response times, I guess, really. And if you get a response that's too long, like 2 seconds, you're bringing up another container. Ultimately, though, those containers need to go away. So that's generally the much harder problem. What are you measuring to determine when and how to shut down which containers?
So
particularly persistence containers.
Well, it's the same way as figuring out when to scale up. I mean, there's no specific metric you have to use. You can define whatever you want. If you want to use the latency that between when a request is received and when a response is sent as your metric, or you can use CPU usage per second, whatever you like. So we have to look at it the same way. Figure out how to scale down the service. And it is a bad answer because anytime you're saying that, well, in order to do that, we have to kind of look and characterize what that thing is and then kind of fudge something, it means that there's work to be done. That there's something else we need to be doing within the framework, within the infrastructure to take that away, to make that generic. I wish I had that answer because if I did, I'm sure I would have known this problem. But that's definitely ongoing research.
That is one of the biggest challenges with infrastructure and platform and the way this is set up right now. Like, you know, pulling computers away and pulling services away, ramping things down. And you're talking about the scale. This is the biggest challenge that, say, always happened.
Yeah, you have a bunch of positive actions to scale up. Right. Well, deprovisioning is never, never
really
has
the advantage of this.
Elasticity almost seems to mean grow, which means that essentially you stretch something out and it loses its shape over time, right?
So, I mean, don't get me wrong, there are solutions. I mean, people have implemented solutions, but they tend to be pretty specific to the situation.
Yeah.
I would say that everyone's terrified of creating the next big thing, and the amount of requests for people for that app out on the web that people won't be able to handle or track necessary. So scaling up is always something that's probably scared of. But then all those resources you can now you guys
you,
start
shot your own value prop, right? I mean, you're saying that, hey, I'm making better utilization of resources, I'm allocating less, and now just because we have a spike in traffic, I've done this, and now I don't know how to get them back. But you do have to have an answer. And it would just be nice if I could give you a general purpose one. But there are answers. If you look at what you're doing, there is generally a solution. It just varies. It's the problem.
Mesos, on the board here, I created a tiny URL. There's actually Mesos training here in Austin by Paco Nathan, if you know who he is. If you don't, he's amazing just to watch the guy speak. And he's giving Mesos training on the 25th. Go here, it's an event break thing. Check it out if you're interested.
Oh, yeah, I'm good friends with Paco. He feeds me a lot of information too, so if you won't find it, it's just great.
I was here for the quite clear what actually implemented. Is it the reference architecture?
This talk is very conceptual in nature, so it's not really, I'm not sharing with you a specific thing that I've built. I'm sharing with you concepts of how a lot of the leading edge, I should say, technologies, how they fit together into an ecosystem, what kind of a story and model are they driving towards, and what does that look like? So it's really just about exploring that model and that picture.
Yeah, and have you actually tried and built parts of it, or
I've built a piece of it in test, but not in production. Yeah, with few people.
A lot of what you're showing is I would say, complementary or orthogonal to what, like, Fuse Fabric or something like that does. Which Fuse Fabric really doesn't even address the scalability, but the elasticity side, it just addresses the DSL and the messaging and such as that. Would you propose to, but something like that is a very mature approach. Would you propose that what you're doing on the elasticity side would be married to that kind of a layer, or would you do this? Would you just put in Kafka and completely throw away something like Fuse Fabric?
I would never say anything like that.
There's just so much maturity there that this doesn't have, that does apply, which ties everything together, especially on the ESP.
So you have a couple of different approaches. You have some companies are going to be more risk averse than others. Your traditional, more enterprise type companies are going to have some of these large data centers that have been supporting applications for years. They can be pretty significantly risk averse. Dealing with leading edge technology is not a risk averse approach. I mean, you're taking risk of doing this. Like some of these technologies, honestly, the only companies that are implementing them in production are the very same companies that are developing them. So when they run into bugs, they just get them, they fix it, and they contribute it back to the community. So yeah, only so many companies can run. A vast, long share of companies are going to say, no, I need to wait till that gets more mature, that I really understand that picture, that a company is coming out with a specific product suite that's supportable and all of that. That's a business decision that you have to make ultimately. Because whether you can achieve it with Kafka or you can achieve it with this, it's going to be a matter of, first of all, how does it give you anything over this other? You already own that. You start to make some trade-offs and do some pretty quick math and determine what makes the most sense for you. But this is interesting. I'll put it out there as an option.
Boyd has, you said something once in one of the monitoring talks where it was, I don't know, Copper Egg maybe was coming in. Copper Egg is a great product. You know, and maybe the way to think about it is that when you're starting out, you know, you don't have the internal capacity to manage, I'm not trying to conflate Copper Egg's ability to handle logs and Kafka's ability to handle logs, just a scenario. So I'm going to go out and I'm going to buy a product that does the thing that I want, because that's a whole lot easier than training people to manage something like logs that I should manage Kafka. Company more than you pay a team of developers, they have
something, 60% of what I want, and 20% I'm going to have to tack on to the end of it. Go pay another team of consultants to come in and build my bus to the bus.
Yeah, it's a good argument. Yeah, because you're basically countering what we were saying just a minute ago about saying that, you know, yeah, okay, there's the thing about, you know, being risk averse and wanting to go with something that's proven, but then there's also a trap there. And that you start out small and you're like, okay, yeah, the thing costs, maybe it's $100,000 for initial deployment with this agent on all my servers. Okay, we can deal with that. It's money, but it's not breaking the bank. Okay, we'll do it. And then your product catches on, you start scaling out, and you know, now all of a sudden you've got, you know, 10 times as many servers, and it starts becoming an unmanageable situation. And you may exceed the performance and scalability limitations of the current product that you just put now plus dollars on. So it's something to consider. I mean, and that's a really high level business decision to make. If you want to focus, and now I'm talking as like a CIO, you know, if you want to focus your company in a more engineering direction, this is the kind of stuff you're thinking about. If you don't like that risk, and for various reasons you don't think that, you know, buying, you know, tried and true proven solutions is going to bite you in that way, then you may choose to focus, you know, shift your focus into more of an operational mode and rely on external parties to do that engineering work for you. I guess you need to ask this.
So, Sean, I think I can summarize what you said really shortly, which is where NIH. I think it's always something for every one of us to keep in mind. I can write that in 30 lines of code or less! Until you actually need to use it, yeah.
Yeah, every line of code is a liability. I mean, I think that's a great saying, and I think it holds true. As a developer myself, you know, my background is in software development. I've been guilty of writing millions of lines of code. I'm standing here before you right now saying every line of code is a liability, because it is. We maintain my up in total. Yeah. Recent years when I started looking into working in the cloud and infrastructure and platform services, I was doing big monolithic application development, and that was always my value prop. Why would you want to spend all this money to hire me? Well, my skill is in being able to take your existing million line code base and keep it from crumbling under its own weight. That's my value prop. Find someone else. Yeah. And so, do you want to be in that situation? Is, you know, and so we've got several approaches to that. One is the open source community, the great contributions people are making there, and then also that practice of reducing services to this very minimum discrete piece of functionality, so that you don't have all this tight coupling and dependencies between different functional areas of your solution. It's going to come to that sort of the same kind of conversation we're just having. People love Nagios. Nagios is open source, gives you great details on, you know, what resources are currently being utilized. And I'd say probably the polar opposite end of that scale is a product like AppDynamics. AppDynamics is amazing. So requests are coming into your web server thing. You've got AppDynamics sitting there looking at those requests and tracing into your code. You know, watching what's happening as you're processing that request and then telling you where you're messing up. Okay, but it also costs like $5,000. You know, so yeah. You kind of have to pick where on that spectrum, you know, it makes sense to you from a feature and budget perspective.
Have you had a chance to look at Gambit?
I have not looked at that one. I've heard of it. It has been mentioned, but I honestly don't know anything.
Love and line within your job, a lot of JMXification of the apps, using JMX trans, pull that down into been pretty easy to maintain just put work for all the small
chunks. Yeah, I mean, it depends on the
servers.
Right, and you need to understand what would happen to cause you to need 1,000 servers.
Yeah.
You know, and if you can answer that question, that's one half side already.
Yeah.
At least then you really get your system. You know what it's about. You understand how to characterize it. Then, once you know that, then you can start thinking about, okay, how can I deal with that, and how can I anticipate that that's going to become a trigger issue, and then start putting things in place for comparison. I'm sure we're over time, so I thanks everyone for your patience.